local, breaking news. This is WYFF News 4 at 6 in high definition.
And we do have breaking news for you tonight out of Greenville. An arrest in the case of a special ed teacher found dead in a burned out motel room.
Tonight, police charged this man, 21-year-old Darren Terrell Eskew, with murdering Lori Patton. He is her former student, arrested in Georgia while driving her car. Police believe he strangled her and set the hotel room on fire at a Quality Inn in Greenville.
Police say the two were acquainted because she had taught him in the past. She was a special needs teacher at Berea Middle School. Eskew is in jail in Georgia tonight. More on this at 11 here on WYFF News 4 and on WYFF4.com.
Weather making news tonight, a live look at a rainy Hilton Greenville skycam, but some winter weather is starting to move in.
Chief Meteorologist John Cesarich joins us. John, we're actually going to see more snow in some places, right?
Yeah, especially the mountainous areas. In fact, it'll probably just be in the mountainous areas, Carol and Michael. But take a look at the radar. Watch the temperatures, first of all. See how they were in the 40s, and then with the evaporational cooling, once the precipitation started, look how fast we dropped the temperatures down to the 30s. And a lot of this blue shaded area is actually sleet more than it is snow, but we're going to see sleet and snow through the mountainous areas. And the warnings and advisories really are for most of North Carolina, and I'll talk more about that later in the newscast. The only advisory in the upstate is for northern Greenville County, a winter weather advisory from now until noon tomorrow. So this is mainly sleet, but we're continuing to slowly drop the temperatures in the mid-30s already in Greenville and in Spartanburg. 33 with sleet and snow in Hendersonville, 37 degrees right now in Asheville, 28 degrees with snow in Boone. It's only going to get worse. We'll talk more about it in detail a little bit later on. Now back to you, Michael.
All right, thank you, John. Continuing coverage now of our breaking news from yesterday. Three people shot dead and this high-speed chase that ended, there you saw it, with a stolen truck going airborne. Tonight, the man accused in all this has gone from a hospital to jail, and he is in serious trouble with the law.
The incident report says it all started as an argument on Law Street in Pelzer and escalated. Tara Hendricks told investigators the argument started between her brother and Jared Williams. She says during the argument, Williams pulled a gun and shot her brother, then shot another man. She says she was also shot but managed to get herself under a bed. Hendricks says Jared Williams waited for the last victim, 30-year-old Renee Anderson, to enter the house. He then shot her. Of the four, Tara Hendricks is the lone survivor. She told deputies Williams took off in a dark green Chevy truck and soon sheriff's deputies were after him.
Now, authorities say Williams ditched that first truck and witnesses say he then stole their truck and threatened their lives in the process. Many of you saw the chase right to its dramatic end here via Sky 4. WYFF News 4's Mandy Gaither is live and local in Piedmont where the chase ended yesterday. Mandy, what else have you learned?
Well, Michael, this is where the suspect crashed his car, and as we speak, you can see workers are trying to stabilize it and make it safer for the 85-year-old woman who lives here. But before this crash, witnesses say the suspect pointed a gun at them.
From Sky 4, our camera catches a black truck that had just been stolen. Deputies say Jared Williams was behind the wheel. The triple homicide suspect is seen running over a fence and speeding away in an attempt to evade being captured. Witnesses handed over the keys to this truck after they say Williams threatened their lives.
He came in and faced us, you know, over the gun, you know, saying, give me the keys or I'm going to shoot you. You know, this was I was terrified. You know, I don't know what was going, you know, was going to happen, you know. We gave him the keys and he took off and went to the field here.
Out of fear, this man did not want to be identified, but said Williams pointed what looked like a silver 9mm gun at him and his neighbor. The man says Williams had a straight face the whole time, but was disoriented.
It was like he was high on something. I didn't know what it was, but it was like he was high on something. Because he didn't know where he was. He did say when he walked up, I did already kill three or four people, and I won't hesitate to kill you if you don't give me the keys.
Right here are the tracks, of course.
Jan Allison got an up-close view of Williams, too, as he sped through her yard trying to get away. Sky 4 shows Allison and her family having to jump out of the way.
I was shaking pretty badly. I didn't know what was going on. It just happened so quickly. I mean, we're like, what is going on our property here? You know, we had no idea.
The chase ended when Williams went airborne and crashed into this house.
Just thanking God that she wasn't here.
An 85-year-old woman lives in the home but has been sick and staying with her daughter, Peggy Brown.
You just never know from one day to the next if you're going to be safe when you get out on the streets or if you're safe in your home anymore.
Williams was hurt in the crash and taken to the hospital. Charges are still pending.
And several witnesses have told me today that they saw a girl in the truck with Williams after the murder. I did question investigators on that today, and they said that they weren't able to comment on that because of the ongoing investigation, but say they do expect to release more information tomorrow. And of course, we'll keep you posted. Mandy Gaither, WYFF News 4, live in Piedmont.
Mandy, thank you. Jared Michael Williams has a criminal record that dates back to 1997. In fact, his criminal history from the South Carolina Law Enforcement Division is 7 pages long. The SC Department of Corrections says Williams was sentenced in 2005 to 10 years in prison for armed robbery, but under state law, Williams was released from prison and able to serve the last 15% of his sentence under Anderson County supervision. In fact, we've learned he was reporting to his probation officer and was in good standing.
Now to Greenville County, where the sheriff's office tells us about a break in a murder case from late last year. They have arrested a couple of teenagers in this. 17-year-old Conrad Allen and 18-year-old Damian Robinson, multiple charges for both. Deputies say it's all connected to the death of Everardo Campos. The crime happened back in November on Dixie Circle off White Horse Road. Investigators tell us Campos was approached by two men, an argument broke out, and Campos was shot twice in front of his home.
A fire killed a woman and her daughter despite the bravery of a boy and a bystander. WYFF News 4's Mike McCormick takes us to the scene in Cherokee County.
So there were fire trucks everywhere, smoke and everything.
Angie Horn came to work at Auto Stop Food Mart this morning and found out that the victims...
It breaks my heart.
...and a witness...
In my opinion, he was a hero.
...involved in the fire next door are all her regular customers.
It's just a terrible thing. It's a terrible thing.
The home began burning around 4:30 a.m. here on Cherokee Avenue.
It woke us up because of the talking and the noise outside.
Jarvis Humphreys lives behind the house.
We prayed for him and just hoping that everyone was safe.
What he didn't know was that 5 people were inside.
There was a little bit of flame coming out the front, but the house was engulfed with smoke. Too quick.
Robbie Teague was walking by. He ran to the store, asked the owner to call 911, then ran into the burning home.
You couldn't hear nothing but rumbling of the flame.
He says the smoke...
I couldn't help all of them.
...kept him from making a rescue.
Nothing but smoke. Front, back, side, and then the flames started coming out the windows.
The coroner tells us a 12-year-old boy and his grandparents got out, but the boy's mom went back in to rescue his sister. He broke a window trying to get to them, but 43-year-old Evelyn Rodriguez and her 11-year-old daughter Lynette died in the house.
It breaks my heart. Those children were wonderful children, and the fact that that little girl, I mean, that's really sad.
The Gaffney fire chief tells us the investigation has shown that a heating source was not the cause of the fire here. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4 in Cherokee County.
Greenville Police Chief Terry Wilfong is talking about her plans to retire next month. The chief says she's ready to leave the spotlight for good after more than 30 years in law enforcement. She plans to do consulting work, which will allow her to spend more time with her family back home in Kentucky. Terry Wilfong did break a barrier when she came to Greenville in 2007, becoming the city's first female chief. But she says the heart and soul of the department are the 200 officers she leaves behind.
To say that I'm the police chief here, I'm very honored and very proud to have had that role, and it's been a heck of a ride.
Now, violent crime in the city of Greenville has gone down since Terry Wilfong became chief. That's according to crime numbers from the FBI. WYFF News 4 Investigates broke down the numbers, and Gabrielle Komorowski found improvements across the board since 2007. But, Gabby, you also noticed a slight increase in some crimes in the recent years, right?
I did, Michael. We looked at the FBI's violent crime numbers for the city of Greenville in 2007 when Wilfong became chief and compared them to the numbers midway through her time as chief in 2010 and the most recent numbers available, which are for the year 2012. Now, first, let's talk about the crimes where we're seeing a slight increase. There were 453 cases of aggravated assault in 2007. That went down to 321 in 2010, but the number of cases rose to 383 in 2012. Still, that is lower than the number of cases in 2007. And here are the numbers for motor vehicle theft: 364 in 2007, down to 169 in 2010, and then the numbers go up again to 209 in 2012, but still lower than the number of cases when Wilfong became chief in 2007. We did notice a similar trend for burglary and property crime numbers, but again, overall crime in Greenville is still lower than it was when Wilfong became chief in 2007. We won't see crime stats for 2013 until later this year. And this week, Chief Wilfong told WYFF News 4 that the police department's clearance rates, the rate of solving crimes, have gone up during her time as chief, and that is something she is very proud of.